Hello and welcome to The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Rakhee, Bakshee. In this show, as you know, every week we bring you new personalities, personalities who matter and they have a name, and also the views and vision that they share with us is very important for all of us to understand and maybe get inspired from. So the guest this week with us is also a very important leader. He's the National General Secretary of the BJP, somebody who we have also known as heading Swadeshi Jagran Manch, also an important RSS leader. Mr. Muralidhar Rao is present in the studio. Welcome to the show, Mr. Rao. So we are meeting at a time when the government, of course, has completed 1 year already. But as everybody would believe that this word called chasm, the word called, we were talking also, this whole burden, I would say, of expectation. How would you look at this government actually facing all this at this juncture?
In the whole country, particularly the young people, they have got a lot of expectations from Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And during the political campaign and before elections and all these programs have definitely ignited these kind of expectations. So the performance of Narendra Modi ji's 1 year and this government, it is not between the opposition and their charges or their own performance in the past and what this government is doing presently. Expectations versus performance. So people have got lot of expectations, and that is evaluated. The performance is evaluated on the basis of those expectations.
Mm-hmm. But as opposition, of course, would say that where has it actually delivered? I mean, on the whole promises and the bunch of promises that were made during the elections, let's say on the economic ground or on the social ground, on politically, of course, it has. There has not been major changes, so to say. But you have still sometimes problem with your allies like Shiv Sena or Akali Dal. So how would you really rate it in a very holistic manner?
No, definitely. If you see this 1 year, opposition's political charge that this government has not done substantially or not done any differently from the past government is completely wrong. It does not stand on ground. If you see this, unlike UPA, this government has performed without any kind of corruption charges or scams. It's a corruption-free government this leadership has given. Mm. And also, if you take Prime Minister going to the different countries is okay. But if you take this SAARC countries, they started with Bhutan, Nepal, and now very recently Bangladesh, and in between Sri Lanka. Mm. So where we had problems with all these governments, and the kind of impression which we had was that India is behaving like a big brother and not attending. And sometimes India's growth was that these even small countries, they are not listening to India, and they are,
there are problems in a way.
Dealing with China and this and that. So if you see with that kind of situation, it is completely changed now.
Would you like to speak about China? Because I would say that maybe you have had a different kind of perception or expectation even as a leader, that how our relationship or strategic relationship with China should be. There have been visits from both the countries.
Definitely, after this government came in, the serious preparation is we have to understand China is a very important country like India. Mm. And there is a paradigm shift towards Asia. Now the economy is shifting and the power is shifting towards Asia. For the last 200 years, it was the whole world was driven by Europe and then afterwards America. Now it is shifting towards Asia. In that context, if you see the two important countries are going to be participating in shaping the future of the world will be definitely India one side and the China other side. In that situation, India's leadership for the first time has started engagement process with China. So this engagement with the kind of confidence which is required that internally you are stable and internally you are capable of delivering and you are going to handle the situation.
So do you think that India's position in the whole geopolitical map is going to be a little different with Mr. Modi's visits? Of course, these visits itself have been talked about as to why so many and so often maybe. But then do you think it's going to actually make a difference?
100% this is going to be a changed situation. After 2 or 3 years, the change will be perceived by even common man. One side, as a big country, you are aspiring to become the Security Council member.
Hmm.
And you were not interested in engaging with the countries. You were not interested in dealing with the countries. Today, the situation is completely changed. The first circle of influence for India will be definitely the SAARC countries. And you have started sorting out the problems with all those countries.
You would call this Bangladesh visit also successful?
100% is successful, and the kind of atmosphere now created, the confidence is now created, trust which is created, definitely. Leadership has taken a personal responsibility in sorting out this problem.
And Nepal, even Sri Lanka. Nepal, that Prime Minister took personal interest in, I would say, and the kind of tragic situations it saw in terms of earthquake. Do you think we've really reached out to Nepal in the best of manner?
The very beginning Narendra Modi ji made with the Nepal, going to Nepal and addressing the parliament and addressing the even people in Nepal. Then when the Nepal was facing the crisis, came out of earthquake, then India as a country, neighbor country, is responsible, and it has taken the responsibility of providing the help and support.
Mm-hmm.
So these two things have created enormous goodwill, not only in Nepal, even all neighboring countries, that India is there as a supporter. Ready to help us.
So foreign policy is something that you would say that this government is actually taking new aspects into consideration. It is taking consideration of new dimensions also. Would you
definitely here dealing with the countries like China is one, and another the neighboring countries, and even we are ready to provide economic help and aid to the neighboring countries in terms of providing the satellite support and other defense supports. So all these things show that this government has changed the complete.
How would you, as also here as somebody who's been associated with the Sangh, would look at this whole idea of bringing investments in India from abroad? Why not really look at our own people? I mean, how would you really look at it?
Here. You know, as a person who has been heading Swadeshi Jagaran for so many years, now I can say, India is a country which is different from others. We have got a lot of savings. Saving rate in India is very high. 29% to 35% of the GDP is coming from the Indian savings. So, as a country, our reliance and our dependence on the foreign capital is always a kind of supplementary. It has never been a mainstay of the Indian investments. So, in this situation, there is never a feeling that we are against the foreign investment.
Really?
But
because this is one area that you really make strong statements.
Yeah, but definitely, there should be a level playing field was the always contention. And today, when we go outside, it is not that foreign investment is going to come and it is going to lift the economy. Never. It is not going to be. Indian government is conscious of all these things. And capital has to come from the Indian savings and the Indian people. But definitely,
do you see sometime a dilemma there? Did you actually, as a leader here, would see a little bit of dilemma? I would use that word again.
No, it's not the question of dilemma. Because the domestic investments were not given the level playing field, there was an opposition for the foreign investment. Once it is sorted out, and once you create the a kind of business friendly atmosphere for the domestic investment, and definitely its capacity to absorb the foreign investment will also go high, it's go up. So, foreign investment coming into India to help us, is not an unwelcoming thing.
Because let's look at China, and our whole economic and economic angle is seen through that prism of China, and we are talking to them. We have problems, let's say, at the boundary, but as far as economic relations are concerned, there are complexities.
You know, here, China's case is different from India. China has been a closed economy for a long time. And when they talk about the foreign investment, many a times the Chinese, non-resident Chinese coming to China also is a foreign investment.
Mm-hmm.
And all entrepreneurs in China, they went out of China. because it was a communist economy, it was a public sector economy, it was a state economy. Whereas in India, if you take all Indian entrepreneurs, mm-hmm. Indian companies, they have been doing well and they have got their investments in this country. So when you open up, it is not that non-resident Indians coming and they were not working here earlier. It is not the situation. Situation is completely different. Now, when we deal with China and India in economic issues, definitely there is a large trade deficit between China and India and to the advantage of China.
Yeah.
And Indian leadership has to work, Indian government has to work on that issue, how to create a balance between China and India.
So there is a continuous effort to work on that, you're saying that.
And China also has to take that
step forward.
Prosperous Indian economy is good for China.
Yeah. So on that note, we are going to take a very short break because there are many other issues and important ones that we're going to talk about. But here, you're watching The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. We are in conversation with Mr. Muralidhar Rao. We'll continue to ask him many questions still, but after this very short break. So welcome back to the show once again. You're watching The Quest here on Rajya Sabha TV. We are talking to Mr. Muralidhar Rao here. Many questions still, and let me begin the second break by asking him about economy, which is rural. So let's come to agriculture. And very, very important. I think one of the five key challenges that the government has listed, agriculture actually maybe tops the list. How would you look at this whole huge agrarian crisis that is facing India today?
Agriculture crisis is the legacy we have got from the inherited from the UPA government. It is in deep crisis. And there is restlessness among the farmers. But the BJP's credibility is very high. Wherever we were in the government, if you take, we were ruling in Gujarat, we are ruling in Gujarat, and we are in Madhya Pradesh, we are in Chhattisgarh, wherever we are in power, there our performance in the agriculture sector has always been high. And Madhya Pradesh, in fact, has got the best state which has performed well in agriculture, above 15% growth rate and above 17% growth rate, when the whole national average is 2% or minus percent.
No, but the government itself is saying that huge attention or maybe a different kind of attention should be given to agriculture to get out of this whole tragic situation. We are seeing again farmer suicides happening. We are seeing all this anguish among farmers with the come on the streets. So are you working on some solid formula to really come out?
Definitely, this government in the very beginning, it has changed that the drought affected situation. 50% of the crop loss to now 33%.
Shortfall
this
in
government
rains
has reduced. So this has given a kind of cushion for the farmers. Now the second point is the irrigation infrastructure. Creation of irrigation infrastructure is given the top priority now in this first budget. Definitely it has to increase that year by year. And the important thing in coming days, this government is going to address on the credit issue, on the market issue, and the inputs. And this government also has done one remarkable,
but the government is also
thing.
Seriously into this whole complexity of land acquisition bill. I mean, the opposition, suggested certain amendments. Certain amendments you've looked into, but there are still one or two very critical points that you have to work on.
You know, land acquisition should not be taken as the problem between the industry and agriculture. You know, it is presented in such a way. I don't think there is any problem between industry and the agriculture. And this government is not going to create a rivalry
but
between
the
industry.
But the accusation is that maybe it's tilted towards corporates and the industry.
But this government has, adequately it clarified that this government is not interested in working as a kind of middleman and taking the land from the farmers and transferring it to the corporate. It is not going to do. This land through acquisition, it will be taken only for the purpose of infrastructure creation, rural infrastructure, rural industrialization, rural electrification, and water irrigation. And land is acquired in 80% cases.
Do you think you're being understood? Do you think you're being understood? What you're saying? Do you think the people at the right places are understanding?
Initially, there were some kind of apprehensions among the farming community because of the opposition's charge. But as we have taken up this responsibility, now reaching out to the people and conducting the programs, and there is dialogue programs, worked out. Through all these programs, now we have been able to dispel this kind of apprehension.
Let's look at another one, the GST bill. Again, it relates to states. And of course, your intention is good. But again, look at the hurdles. How would you look at it?
you know, this is this issue, GST issue, should not be seen through the prism of party politics. Now,
that's what every political party which gets into a problem says that.
You know, lot of discussions have taken place, and the engagement is already done, and state governments have been taken into confidence, and their issues have been considered, and ultimately GST can be unrolled only when the state governments accept and there is a consensus largely. We are moving to that end to the large extent. And when GST bill is a long pending issue, once it is gets implemented, definitely the kind of uniformity and integration of economy
will be seen.
And achieved. And this government has assured the leadership of the different state governments in different states that you are not going to lose anything. And center.
Let's see how much the this whole idea gets home to these roots.
And this is leadership has also, even particularly the Prime Minister has said that we will be working on the basis of the cooperative federalism. And 14th Finance Commission report also has been accepted, and thereby this government has been able to increase the revenue share for the state governments. So in this situation,
you're talking about revenue, so it takes me to another section, which is social security area. And among the social sections, I think this time the budget has been reduced on many such issues and areas, and many of your schemes. I think the kind of financial assistance this would need, they are not really very, very optimistic. Well,
no,
there are a whole list of areas and issues.
The architecture is now this time changed. Now state governments have been allowed to have the autonomy, and they are given more freedom to prepare their own schemes and work out their own schemes, keeping their interests, the social sections and different sections in different states and their needs, keeping that in view, they can work out more efficiently. This has been the view. So,
because even something like Women Child Development, Ministry feels that, why there should be a cut in budgetary.
When you work out a different architecture, definitely in the beginning people will have some kind of doubts and some kind of because they have been doing in a different way. But state governments are expected to take up all these issues in a very effective way and very efficient way. So this government has taken always, the state governments are partners in the whole nation building process and the governance process. So, state governments are not seen as a kind of adversaries or a different players.
So, do you think the dialogue is going in the correct manner? I mean, when you're creating a dialogue with the states and trying to convince them, do you think it's all good, it's all comfortable?
So far, definitely this is going in the right direction. And the different state governments which have been taking a different view on different issues, now slowly they're also joining and they are also getting convinced.
Maybe now that Mamata Banerjee has gone, maybe
convinced.
Somebody who is being seen as somebody who, is not comfortable with many issues.
Yeah, so now the state governments cooperating with the central government, the situation is going well. I don't think this problem will get aggravated. In coming days, ultimately, the leadership at the center, how much it is able to satisfy the state governments and how much it is able to really share. So these are the things.
Some of the quick developments which have happened, and I think this I must ask because a lot of people are talking about it, this whole ban on Maggie now. Of course, this is an issue which was taken after lead was found in this product. But then it is creating a whole lot of debate as to maybe why and how.
Definitely in coming days, these are all food-related products. They have to work within the stringent norms created by the government and by the health
standards. There is no particular targeting, you mean to say?
No, definitely. This government is not seen as a targeting somebody. And it is a people's opinion which is driving the whole thing. Definitely in coming days, every company and every manufacturer, every producer has to keep all these things in view. Here in this aspect, government is only there to protect the interests of the consumer.
Okay. Now, some of the things that I would ask in a very holistic manner is that, you know, ideologically, economically, and some of the issues that are critical, of course, to the party and how you as a leader, coming from the core of it all, would look at it. So let's say the whole idea about Ram Janmabhoomi to Article 370 to Uniform Civil Code. You know, earlier when one talked about BJP and one talked about the real ideas of the Sangh, then one would, you know, look at all the, maybe the gaps. How would you really talk about it today?
You know, the whole thing is, when we were talking about those things, the people who were not in agreement with us and who were functioning as opposition, opposition to us, they always used to say that these are the issues which are dividing the nation, dividing the people, dividing the communities and all. Now, why we are not taking these issues? Why we are leaving these issues? Why we are keeping these issues on the back burner? This is the way we are being asked. But one thing we have to understand, ultimately the political party and the leadership which is governing the nation, we are answerable to the people. And during the election campaign, though we have taken up these issues, it is not that we have discarded these issues, that we have left these issues, not at all. These issues are still with us. They are part of the manifesto. But there is a sequence of issues. The sequence is the economic revival. And during elections, this was the hot topic which we also had taken up, and the people also expected a lot from us.
So are you saying that there has been a restructuring in terms of how the party would play up with issues?
Definitely, when it comes to the governance, there is a sequence of issues which the government...
When you're saying sequence of issues, do we see a divergence? I mean, the aspiration, let's say even from the Sangh that it aspired for, and it has a certain path to follow, and how the government functions. Do you see sometimes a conflict?
No, I don't see the kind of conflict here which is working out in this way. But what I would like to say is that definitely even during election campaign, it is not in this election Ram Janmabhoomi which was discussed, or 370 which was discussed, or Uniform Civil Code which was discussed in every public meeting. In every engagement, the discussion was, you know, focused on the corruption-free government. The focus was on the economic revival, employment creation.
Okay.
Once we solve these issues, the trust of the people will also grow. And definitely the different groups which are not in a natural way aligned with us, they will also develop the trust that this government and this leadership...
But certain things come up which I think takes sometimes the trust away. Like, for example, how politicians make statements. I mean, I would even talk about this whole Nathuram Godse statement to sometimes, saying whether how many children one should produce to right now the beef discussion. So, do you think these are just aberrations and you're controlling that? How are you looking at this?
You know, this is a country, which is a vast country, and even our party, and with if you take the whole school of thought, is also has got lot of millions of people working for this party. In this situation, definitely, and media
or
is also
conversion, which I think
media is also interested in creating focus.
No,
on
media
the
did not create these issues. It came up, and
I'm
media
not saying
just looked
that.
At
media
it.
Media is also interested in creating the, you know, a kind of sensation or attention. I am not saying that the people have not spoken and media has created the issue. No. But these are the issues when you have a large movement working in a particular time, context. Definitely, there will be individuals, there will be certain groups which will have a divergent view or perspectives. But you should not take that this is the perspective or this is the priority of this movement now. It is not that.
Okay. So, as we have to right now end this whole program and the discussion, I would like to ask you final questions. Of course, also you, Mr. Muralidhar Rao, coming from a farming background and from a very young position, you've now risen to this level. How has this journey been, and what would you aspire for now?
You know, working for the country and working for the society has always been a very important thing for me in my life. And from the beginning, I never thought I would be one day joining the political party to become a political leader without this kind of awareness or thinking or desire. I have come into the Sangha school of thought and I worked through Sangha in almost all parts of the country.
So, at this stage, are you very comfortable? Are you at peace?
I'm very happy. that BJP and its leadership has given me a very important assignment and scope to work. And definitely it's a challenging thing.
The challenge would be Bihar elections.
Definitely Bihar elections, and the challenging assignment also the party has given me, that to train 15 lakh people within 4 months' time all over the country, the new members who got recruited into the party. So this assignment is also a challenging one. And definitely a party with the new blood. And
so all your ideas, do you think this whole skill development section and this Make in India approach, these ideas are going to be inculcated? People like you who have real ideas from the ground?
Definitely. And the change dimension, if you want to see from this government, what is the, different thing from this government, definitely in coming days, the skilling India. Is a very important thing, and you have got the demographic dividend which is available with us for the next 4 decades. Within these 4 decades, we have to exploit maximum this advantage what we are. And
but isn't that a huge challenge?
Is a very important thing. And when we go to the elections, the next election in 2019, definitely by 2018, what we have done on the skill development side, what is the change we have brought in, that is going to be the important factor.
But I'll quickly just go back to again to this Bihar election and the kind of combination we have seen here coming up, this Janata Parivar. Is that again a huge challenge? Because now your all eyes would be on your victories or no victories in this state election.
If you take the statistics and all other things as a evaluating parameter, then definitely you will take it as a challenging thing. But in Bihar, the issue will be governance, and good governance is going to be the issue. If that issue becomes, I feel it is, I hope this will become the issue in the Bihar. So one side, the person who is are leading or whatever the front you have, that front will not be able to give the impression that stands for the good governance. And BJP will have the advantage with itself.
I think that only time will tell, and we'll have to
definitely
watch that. But so, we'll keep watching even your journey, and it's been very interesting talking to you, Mr. Muralidhar Rao. All the best to you for coming to this show, and we'll keep talking to you about future issues as well. And that was Mr. Muralidhar Rao talking to us on The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. Many issues that he has talked about and range of issues he has answered on also. Hope you like this particular edition of The Quest. Thank you for watching. Namaskar and bye-bye.